I'm just going to open the mic for the first one who wants to start about either a personal anecdote or insight on this subject or on a personal experience, each of them, and then we will open the questions for you guys if you have any to ask one or two of them, inshallah. Just say amen. Put your hands up. Okay.
On the right, Mr.
Assalamu alaikum, or Danny. Alhamdulillah, it's an honor for me to be here. Alhamdulillah, sharaf li, nkun ma'akum liyum. Alhamdulillah, Allah jazikum bi khair, Allah jazik si al-arabi, si hasan, da'wah. The topic today is youth and progress. And I thought, for me, I'd like to just tell you about my personal story a little bit, and inshallah, it'll be clear how this relates. So, my name is actually Emmanuel. I was born with the name Emmanuel Weinman in the 1970s. I was born in 1978 in New Mexico, in the United States. الأب ديالي هو من واحد عائلة قديم يهودية من بولانيا and my mother is a white American from a Protestant Christian family so I was raised essentially without any religion. I was raised American. ماشي نصراني ماشي يهودي ماشي مسلم أمريكي بهذا واحد الدين. One of the beliefs of this deen to be an American is to believe in progress. We were raised with the idea that things are getting better. It's a deep assumption. Are you able to follow? Do you understand my English?
Yes.
Okay. And so there's this idea that American culture is moving in a direction, and that what's behind you is worse, is not as good as the direction that you're moving in, and that things are getting better. So new things are good. Old things are bad. We don't talk about it, but it's understood culturally. So I was raised through this culture. I went through school. I had a good education. Alhamdulillah, I was a good student. I got into some trouble, of course, like many of you, I'm sure. But not too much trouble, never anything too dangerous, alhamdulillah. Then when I was 18 years old, I had the opportunity to come to Morocco. I had always, as a child, I always wanted to travel. I wanted to see the world, I wanted to visit a new place. And I first went to Europe. I visited England, I visited France, and for me as an American, it was somewhat different, but not very different. And I thought, no, this is not what I want. I want something that's really different, really. And a bit she has a يعني يكون بحال شي قنبولة شي حاجة يعني شي تقدر ليا يعني يأثر فيا ماشي شي حاجة بحال يعني in England they drive on the left side of the road. واخا it's interesting but it's not meaningful. So I came and my father alhamdulillah he knew someone who lived in Fez. In fact a man that Sid Arabi knows, a man named David Casewit. Who ran a language school in Fez. And he said, go visit this man and hopefully you'll have a good experience. So I came down on the train
through Europe, down into southern Spain, and then I took the ferry across from Algeciras to Tangiers. And this is in 1996. Maybe some of you were born about that time. I feel old now. But I came in 1996, and so I was 18. I was probably the same age as some of you, so I was a youth. I mean, this was... I came to Tangiers, and it was different. When I... مجرد دخلت ذاك 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 المحطة ديال ديال تما كان ذاك الناس ديال الطاكسي على جينا كي غوتو كي داشي سبحان الله it was like and I thought okay this is what I wanted this is new this is different so I alhamdulillah got a taxi I came to Fez and it was in January It was very cold. It was cold. It was rainy. It was for me. It was dirty. And very quickly, I experienced a lot of culture shock. Like كيقولوا صدمة ثقافية. And الناس كتكلمشي لغة ما I didn't speak any Arabic at that time ما فهمت والو في ذاك الساعة وبحال and it was Ramadan so الحمد لله والشكر لله I made friends with a wonderful man there named Sidi Abdul Hafid he's an Arabic teacher there And we would meet in the evenings, because it was Ramadan, so we'd meet in the evenings after the Taraweeh prayer and sit and have a cup of coffee together. And we started to talk. And this man, Sidi Abdul Hafid, Allah Jazeera bi khair, kan hakim. Huwa ma tkalimsh ma'i fi al-deen. Tkalim ma'i عن القلب and العلاقة ما بين القلب والروح مع الخالق ما تكلمش في الإسلام ما تكلم we weren't talking about religion or something because I was alhamdulillah I was explaining to him how I felt I said you know I don't know why I left all my friends in the United States I was happy I had a life And now I'm here in Fez, what did I do? You know, I don't know anyone, I don't understand the language. Did I make a mistake? Because I was supposed to stay for 3 months. yeah. He understands. If you're going to live there for a while, it's very hard. And so I was having a lot of this sort of culture shock, and it was difficult. One night, I was telling him, why I'm not comfortable here, but I also, when I was in the United States, had to tma ma kunch mutlah jiddan. Ana kunt brit shi haja, ana kunt brit taqaddum, shakhsi, the progress, ana brit shi haja, ana brit dir shi haja, ana brit shi haja ma kanch fi lhayat diyali. ولكن انت هنايا انا ما مرتاحش وضحك هو نظر الي وضحك وقال الحمد لله دابا فهمتي كيفاش انا ما فهمت والو هو قال لي فهمتي الان ان 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 دار الروح او الراحه الروح مشي في الدنيا ما لا علاقة بمكان شي حاجة آخر and this was like what are you talking about what do you mean but it really affected me because I was looking at the world as a I was trying to be happy through the world through my situation if only I could, you know, have more friends, if only I could have better education, if only I could have a better house, then I'll be happy. What I realized was that wasn't the goal. That couldn't be the goal. And alhamdulillah, so that, I didn't become Muslim at that moment. It wasn't like, you know, heaven opened and oh. But it was the beginning. It was like I realized that the dunya was a wasila for me to understand myself and to understand, to inshallah, to know Allah, inshallah. And it's a continuing path. It's not a one time. Anyway, so I had this experience. My experience in Morocco changed, and I started to enjoy it. I started to study Arabic, and I continued through my time in Morocco. I started to learn a little bit about Islam. I learned about the prayer. I learned the Fatiha, and actually, I don't tell people this, but I started to do the prayer, the Salat al-Khams.
It's secret.
It's sirri. And as people would Sunni ناس كيقولوا هل أنت مسلم وأنا خفت من هذا السؤال أنا لا أنا مش مسلم لأن المسلمين they were scary يعني مخي أنا في تكساس أنا أمريكي أنا ما أعرفش أنا ما مرتاح but when I learned about Islam I liked it, I really appreciated it. So I started doing the prayer and أنا واحد مرة أنا صليت خمس مرات في النهار وحدي وسبحان الله ذاك الليلة أنا حسيت سبحان الله أنا بقيت هذا أنا بقيت قاعد اتصال مع الخالق ديما ماشي هذا اليوم أنا بقيت ديما الحمد لله. I went back to the United States. I didn't become a Muslim because I wasn't sure if it was something that I just experienced in Morocco or was it something that I could carry with me in my life. So I went back to the United States, and within 2 weeks I realized I need this even more in the United States. And this is something very important I want to mention, is that in Morocco, Islam is all around us. We hear the adhan, we see, I look out and I see Muslim, I can see the signs of Islam on people, in our clothing, you see masjids everywhere, you turn on the radio, you hear the Quran, and so there's a way that it can become passive, where we absorb it, but we're not producing it. Does this make sense?
Yeah.
And so when I went to the United States, there was nothing about that. I went back to my university, nobody's praying, you don't hear the adhan, nothing is reminding you. إِنَّ الذِّكْرَ لَتَنْفَعَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ ثُمَّ مَكَانَ الذِّكْرَ. There's nothing to remind you, there's nothing to help you stay in touch. And I had to make a decision to become an active participant rather than passive, to be active. And alhamdulillah, by chance, about 2 hours from my university is a place, there's actually a mosque in the middle of nowhere, in the middle of the countryside. And at that time, there was a man named Sheikh Hamza Yusuf who was there giving a retreat. There was some activities, and I heard about him, and I heard about this place, and I went directly, and alhamdulillah, I took shahada with Sheikh Hamza Yusuf there, and that started my journey. And that's the beginning. I mean, alhamdulillah, the story goes on. But Sidi Hassan asked me to, if I go forward, My wife, I got married after a couple of years to a woman who is Moroccan and American. And we decided to come back to Morocco and have our family here. And I started teaching people like yourself. I started teaching English at the American Language Center in Marrakesh, Centre Américain. And then we opened our own school, alhamdulillah, and it's very successful. We run different programs, language programs. But one question that people often ask me, especially people your age, they say, "Anta Amriki?" And I say, "Alhamdulillah." Oh, people, Muslim. Oh, and is it in the Maghreb? Yes, British. It's a legitimate question. Because if we think of progress, if we think of societal progress, like we're going in one direction and what's behind us is bad and what's in front of us is good, there is a way, economically, politically, that the United States is in front of Morocco. There's a reality to that in terms of the dunya. But there's something I think that might be wrong about this whole concept that progress is better going forward. And this is what I think the question for tonight really is. You know, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in a hadith, he said, "The best generation is my generation." You know this hadith?
Yeah.
I don't know it in Arabic, I'm sorry. خَيْرُ الْقُرُونَ قَرْنِي ثُمَّ الَّذِي يَلِي ثُمَّ الَّذِي يَلِي. And so in other words, this is the opposite of progress. This means that there was a point then that was the apex of civilization, the highlight, and that things are actually getting worse. But there's a point. There's something very important in the hadith, because then the Prophet ﷺ says, And as far as I understand, it can be one person or it can be a community of people. There are different opinions that it can be, and what does this mean? What is this tajdeed? What is this, you know, renewal of faith, of community? And I would say, for me, I felt like I experienced that as becoming a Muslim. There was a type of tajdeed in my own life that happened. And so for me, living in Morocco is progress in a very real way. And so it's all these questions that Si Bouayyed raised for tonight, they're important questions, and I don't have the answers, but I'm excited to hear from you and hear from our other speakers. So Allah Jazikum Khair. One of the things I think that's important about that is that even experientially, we think that progress is happening because we're growing. As an individual, we are developing, we're learning new things, we're getting older, we're going from being a student to working, we're getting a new job, getting a promotion. And so there's a sense of progress moving forward. But we also know the arc of life has another side, that we have a type of progress and then we get old. And we can't run as fast. We can't jump as high. We can't. We forget things. We get weak in our body. And so progress is not this constant. It's not. it's not ever growing, it's not ever existing. Does that make sense? And so we have to recognize that. So it's not just a concept, it's not just something out there, progress, but it's even in our own lives, we think it's happening, but there's something else that's more cyclical, that's more like a circle, that's not a straight line always continuing up. So. Thank you, Mandy. Well, this is going to be fair. It's a good question, and I don't know if you're familiar with the word privilege, but this is a word that's very important right now in contemporary American culture. And you're right. I'm white. I'm a man. I'm healthy. Alhamdulillah. I'm from a middle-class family, and so I have the privilege to think about my soul, and to have that be important to me, to be a priority that I can focus on that. And I recognize that for someone, I mean, Sidi Ayman, his family is slightly different because they chose to go live in Oman. But I'm sure there are a lot of families that have to live in situations where they don't have water, where they don't have electricity. It's not a choice. They don't have a choice, like you're mentioning about choices. And all I can say is that, you know, you're going to need, as Moroccans, you have to find your way, and you have to find a balance between progress in terms of the dunyawi sense and trying to make things better, but don't lose yourself. Don't forget about your soul. Don't forget about, you know, your relationship to Allah, because we're all going to die. You know, that's the reality, is our lives are short. And, you know, we do what we can for our society. I mean, I run a school now in Marrakesh. We have taqriban 70 shakhs kirti ma'ana. And a farhan kul shah kin khalsum wa kin mula alhamdulillah. Subhanallah, can you see people get married, they want to, and Subhanallah, one rizq halal. What more progress can you ask for than to be able to help people to do something like that, to have families? And, so we don't forget about that, but also don't see that as the only goal, because, I mean, the dunya is empty. I'm American, and now we just elected this man Donald Trump to be our president, and it's,
you didn't come on.
Well, I mean, I didn't personally, but we did, and it's a sign that you can't continue progress forever. I mean, I think these are the questions that seem to be raised today, is that, you know, this idea that we're going to always be better and better and better, it's not true. It's not. And so I think that, alhamdulillah, as young Moroccans, you know the expression in English, count your blessings, in the Quran, right? That there are a lot of beautiful things here, and to just because, you know, things might be a little better in Europe or a little better in the United States, it doesn't mean things are bad here. Alhamdulillah, I mean, people come from Africa, sub-Saharan African countries to Morocco, and they say, Subhanallah, this is great. You guys have you have security. Alhamdulillah, I mean, we have safety. We have good, you know, you have schools, you have families, you have mothers and fathers who love you. You know, we can practice our religion, we can find jobs. Alhamdulillah, it's not that bad. Alhamdulillah. So that's, you know, but it's a struggle to find both and to balance between, you know, working in this way and working in this way. But don't give up on either one. That's the only advice I can give if either of you'd like to comment. You've probably heard the hadith where the Prophet, peace be upon him, he said, if the son of Adam had a mountain of gold, he just wants another one. And it's real. I'm sure on Facebook you've seen the little video where the guy who doesn't have any legs sees a person walking and says, oh, I wish I could just walk. And the person walking sees someone on a bicycle and says, oh, I wish I had a bike. And the person on the bike sees a car. Oh, I wish I had a car. And then the car, guy in the car sees a nicer, a fancier car, a better car. And I mean, I know this for myself. I moved to Morocco and I lived in a little apartment with my family. And we just wished that we could have a little more space, a bigger house. We moved, alhamdulillah, we moved to a bigger house. And then I thought, oh, I wish I had like a little villa, like a petite villa. So we moved to a petite villa. And now we live in a petite villa. And in the next neighborhood, they have big villas. And I go for a walk sometimes with my kids. Oh, I wish we had a big villa. There's no end. And so what we realize is that the only what we have control over is our mind and our heart and our perspective. And so what we have to deal with is that, you know, that the greed and the tamar that comes in, and we have to learn to deal with it. And then, inshallah, if we can reach where Sidi Ayman is, where we want to help other people, where we start to turn our attention. How do we help other people succeed? How do we help other people get more and become and to grow and develop? So that's inshallah where we can go. I think we have to recognize that everything that happens in our life it has a reason. That it has an effect on who we are. There's a great talk if you want by Steve Jobs. He passed away, called Connecting the Dots. Connecting the Dots. And he talks about his own life, about creating Apple computers, the Apple company, and how, what things that he did when he was young, that he didn't know why, but then later, they helped him in his life. And I think that that's the most important thing at your age now, is that you don't know exactly where you're going to be in 10 years, 20 years, but you have choices that you can make now about building the foundation. And so whether it's learning English, I mean, it's a very valuable language, whether it's about having good friends, you know, making decisions about where you go, you know, with your, you know, they're very important. And when you have them, you need to learn from them. You need to welcome them and use those for, you know, and not run away from them. So that's one thing that I would say is to you know, when you have those moments where you don't know why you're doing something, you don't know what's happening, trust. And turn to Allah and ask, you know, what am I supposed to do here? And like Sidi Ayman said, work hard, you know, do what you need to keep going. So I just, you know, I think that's it. And every one of you will experience it. Sorry. Every person is going to have difficulty in your life.
We ourselves will still have many others.
Yeah, well, it's still coming. Exactly. And those are they're important times. They're not, you know, it's kind of what's his name,
Bikinbauer.
Stay calm, and you know, keep going in those moments. You know, Shriya, you know, So that, I just think that's an important thing to remember also in this.
Does someone else have a question, please?
Thank you for your question. The fact that you asked the question means that you know the answer. I think recognizing the problem inside of it is the answer. Definitely part of the solution. I mean, understanding the way in which there's been a cut from the roots, and these kinds of things. I'll say two things. The first one is, I'd like to look at the word consumerism. How would you say that in Arabic? Because I think this is a key issue, is that we've become a consumer system. And when I say this, I think Sidi Ayman experienced it with his family when they lived with nothing, and you experience simplicity. You realize what consumerism is. But I want to look at it from a different perspective. I want to look at it from the perspective of these. Is that we've become, especially as youth, that we've started to become people who consume information. When we want to listen to music, when we want music in our lives, we put little things in our ears, and we consume it. When we talk about spirituality and religion, we go to the masjid, or we go and we turn on Iqra, and we consume it. And I want to challenge you to be people who start to produce it. Where you want some music in your life? Let's sing. Let's make music together. You know, learn an instrument. Have something where you can, if you're with your friends, that you can play a little guitar. You can sing a song for them. You can give something. In your relationships with people, try not to be people who are consuming all the time, are taking. How do you give? And I don't know if this is answering your question, but I think that this is a very important part of this question as we move forward in terms of progress, because the world, we can't continue to be consumers. If we all live lives like Americans in terms of consuming, if the Chinese and the in India become consumers like Americans, we're in trouble. We're gonna destroy the earth. And so we have to find ways to stop this eating of everything and start to think about producing. Also, as you know, when you think about work options for yourself in the future, try to think about ways that you can create jobs for people, that you can be a producer of things rather than always a consumer. So that's one thing. The second question about where are we going? I mean, you've probably all heard of Machiavelli, right? And there's the Machiavellian, this idea that the ends justify the means. So if we have a good goal, we can do anything to reach it.
Yeah, she says that Mr. Bouhed, he's their yeah. teacher, and she says he tells them the good end justifies the right or the good means.
Right. And what we have to recognize also as Muslims is that our end is not in this world, and our end is somewhere else. You know, that's the end. And so we have to recognize that that's So when we ask the question, why, what's the purpose of all this? In modern, you know, what's the goal? We have to be very careful. We have to find our goal. Because if we just follow, if we just, you know, do whatever is the latest moda and, you know, follow, whether it's politically, economically, socially, spiritually, religiously, if we just follow, we're in trouble. Because that's what I mean by consumerism, that we just, because...
it's becoming sheep like cattle.
Ooh, and it's really a type of death. And so I would encourage, again, Dickenbauer, you know, slow down. Don't, you know, I like it, you know. And figure out, where are you going? What's your goal in life? And don't, you know, the Prophet, peace be upon him, he said at the end of time, the person sitting is better than the person standing. The person standing is better than the person walking. The person walking slowly, Dickenbauer, is better than the person running. You know, so this is a time where you have to slow down and figure out what your goal is. What is your personal goal? What is your family goal? What is your communal goal? And then work toward it. Because this is the problem, is that our modern modernity is telling us that we don't need to answer the question why. We just have to do it faster and better, and it doesn't, and bigger, you know, and make more money, and but they don't want to talk about why. And that's, I think, and I think that's why we're here together tonight, is to raise the value of the question why, in all of.
We just finished a wonderful evening. When I first was approached about coming, and I was given the theme of youth and progress, frankly, I thought, I have a problem, because I don't know if I fully believe in the idea of progress in the way that other people might be talking about it. But fortunately, when I met Sidi Hassan and Ustad Bouayyad, I was able to express myself and understand how they understood things, and we actually found deep understanding about how progress is, in my mind, is quite misunderstood, and I think that came out quite clearly tonight, that it's a much deeper and much more complicated question than sort of the simple idea of progress as this flowery, beautiful thing that everyone is going toward and everything's getting better all the time. And it was a moment to start to reflect on our own, and meeting with people who, the students who came with wonderful intentions, and I think it's these are the kinds of meetings we need more of, and it's a breath of fresh air. It's a time of khalwa, in one sense, and reflection, which is what we need more of these days, in order to, as my friend Sidi Ayman said, this opportunity, and I thank all of the organizers for inviting me. Alhamdulillah.